So today, my girlfriend and I just finished watching Demon Slayer, and so I was just browsing through like the anime chart, having a look at what is coming up this season, and to my surprise, Precon Season 2 is coming up. And so I thought to myself, well, if Season 2 is coming out, we're probably going to be getting like an influx of new players, potentially. And so I figured, considering we are nearing the first anniversary of the Princess Connect game, why don't we make a 2022 beginner's guide? For you veterans who have been playing for a while, you guys can come along for the ride and potentially like give us new pointers that I potentially have missed. And so whether you are new or old to this channel, hi, welcome to my channel. My name is Lace, and today we're going to be doing a 2022 beginner's guide for this awesome game. I know it looks like a TV show right now, but very soon we are actually going to flick over to the game. And so just a little bit about myself, especially if you are one of the newer players. About a year ago, I started my YouTube channel playing this game right here, Princess Connect. I was one of the soft launch players in Australia, and I have played until today, and I think I've made like over 110 precon videos. It's pretty insane, actually. And so obviously, over this entire year, I've probably learned a lot of different lessons that I would not have known when we started playing this game. So why don't we do a beginner's guide with today's knowledge? All right, and so without further ado, let's jump right into the game itself. So as you can see over here, ID 0, we have a fresh instance of Precon Redive. I'm gonna go ahead and go into the game. I'm probably going to skip a lot of the different things just because I don't wanna ruin your experience, right? You're gonna be like going into the game, you're gonna be like doing this and that. They're gonna teach you a couple of different things. And so I will see you guys at pretty much like the main menu. That or the point at which you can reroll. And so my guys, I just wanted to show you guys this because for me, it's actually really nostalgic considering I haven't seen this screen for well over a year now. And so for you veterans, I just wanted to show you guys this because it is just, again, so nostalgic. But anyway, let me skip right through this and let's head on to the menus. So my guys, here we are at the premium gacha. This is pretty much the first point where you kind of start deciding whether you want to reroll or not. And to get here, it only takes about maybe like 2 or 3 minutes maybe, and you can definitely multi-instance this. If you do want to learn more about re-rolling, you can check it out on my channel. I definitely have a video on that. Although it's probably a year old, it is certainly still relevant. And so here I am going to go ahead and hit this draw one. Let's see what we get, and hopefully we are going to get something spiky. No, spicy, not spiky. I don't want something spiky. That's freaking weird. All right, so we are going to get... Oh, that was spiky. That was... Oh my god. Oh my god. Okay, the reason I say oh my god, because this character, her name is Makoto. And Makoto is essentially the character that you want to be re-rolling for in this game. A massive reason as to why is because she is essentially universally used. She's used in PvP, she's used in clan battles, which are kind of like clan-wide raids. She is used in Lunar Tower, which is our equivalent of Endless Tower. She's used in essentially every single event boss, in everywhere, story mode everywhere, literally everywhere. And so my guys, if you are willing to re-roll, this is actually your re-roll target right here. Other than Makoto, you could actually re-roll for the current rate up character, and that is New Year's Hiyori. However, between New Year's Hiyori and Makoto, I would actually take Makoto over here, despite her being a permanent character. All right, so that was kind of lucky, but I'm gonna skip through this and let's see if I can get to somewhere where I can start actually talking through this game. All right, so we are now in Juno Plains 1-2 in the normal mode. I just wanted to go through the battle system really quickly. And so as you can see here, we have a team of 5 units. We have Pekarin up the front, Makoto second, Kokoro third, Kiaru fourth, and Yui fifth. Their positions are actually predefined, and typically speaking, they're like defined from how far they are from the front. So for example, Pekarin's position is like 300 from the front, 300 units. Makoto's is 350. And so therefore, Makoto is going to be standing behind Pekarin. And then just like building on that example, perhaps Kokoro's range is 500. And so that's why she is standing over here. And then naturally we have our mages and healers in the back line at about like 700 to 900 range. So that is actually what dictates the positioning of each of these characters. Unfortunately, this is kind of like their inherent stat, so you can't really change it. Similar to how a unit, if it was like a fire type, then it's a fire type. You can't really do anything about it, right? And so the next thing I want to talk about are these gauges down here. So obviously the green bar is your HP bar, but then we have the TP bar down here, which is denoted by your blue bar. And so I'm just going to pause it real quick. So when your blue bar reaches full, essentially you can use your UB, your Union Burst. And in a nutshell, your Union Burst is essentially an active skill. That's pretty much it. There's a whole bunch of different Union Bursts doing different things, especially based on their archetype. So for example, Pekarin is a tank. When Pekarin uses her UB, she's going to get tankier. For Makoto, Makoto is a defense shredder. And so when she uses her active, she does some damage as well as shreds some defense. On the other hand, we've got Yui over here, who's a healer, and you can already imagine what her UB does. We've got Kiaru, an AoE mage, and then we've got Kokoro, who does some support things. So honestly, the system's not overly hard. Like, I could turn off the auto mode and then like manually time these active skills. Like, despite the bar filling to blue completely full, I don't actually have to use that active skill at that moment in time. And so you did hear me talk about Makoto, so how she has defense down, right? As you can imagine, I would want to spam like defense downs all first and then use damage skills after that, stuff like that, right? And honestly, if all of that doesn't really make sense, like, don't worry about it, because it will come with time. There's actually a lot of complexities in this game, but otherwise that's pretty much like the battle mechanics in a nutshell. So it looks like I finally have free reign over my controls, and this is New Year's Hiyori. She is a limited character. Don't be too alarmed about these characters, like these limited characters, don't FOMO into them, because they actually do come back, especially these like New Year's ones, or like these summer ones, or like the Halloween ones, the seasonal ones. They definitely come back like every single seasonal, so don't worry about it. Again, New Year's Hiyori over here, she is quite good. You definitely could reroll for her, but like my recommendation is still gonna be reroll for Makoto. All right, so let's click right past this and land into our menu. Not quite yet. We have Kokoro's good luck stamp sheet. So I think this is actually featured in the anime, which is kind of cute. So essentially this is just your daily login. There's not overly much to it. There's also this jump start login bonus. So essentially if you log in for the next 10 days, you get a whole bunch of jemmies, which is nice. And then we have our first anniversary countdown. So honestly, it's actually quite a good time to start playing this game, because at this moment we are getting a whole bunch of goodies. There is, I'm pretty sure there's actually one more event after this. Look at this. I am spammed with events. New Year's Fortune. So I think this one, we just like shake a little bit and then we get some jemmies. Maybe we get, oh, we got it. We got the bad luck. Psych, we got the princess luck. Let's freaking go. Okay, that's pretty cool. That was actually really cool. So obviously princess luck is the best luck that we could get. Like, the girls did not let us have the bad luck, which is really sweet. But yeah, like I said, like, it's actually a really, really good time right now to start playing the game because of all of these different login bonuses and our countdown to the anniversary. But to be honest, like, you really could actually wait until anniversary to start, because there's going to be like free rolls. It's going to be like a lot of crazy stuff going on. And on top of that, one of the most important characters are probably going to be available on anniversary. But alas, this is a beginner's guide. So let's come back down over here into the menu and let me walk you through a couple of these systems. So up here in the top left-hand corner, we have the EXP gauge, which denotes your player level, and your player level is essentially the highest level that your units can go to. So to really illustrate that, let me go into the characters. And as you can see, my Makoto over here, she is level 2. So I can click into her and here is her equipment system. These equipments can all be farmed. There's no like RNG on the equipment, but there is RNG on the equipment acquisition. And in regards to that, I will talk about that very, very soon. However, let's go over to the level up menu. And okay, so I don't have any EXP pots, but like what I was trying to say before was that because my player level was level 4, if I had EXP pots over here, I would be able to use them on Makoto and she would only be able to go up to a maximum of level 4. And so skills work in a similar way. Coming over here, as you can see, skills are gated behind a couple of different things, ranks 2, 4, and 7. And what this rank means is essentially, if I go back to equipment over here, you can see that she is at rank 1. So when I fill out all of these equipments, I can actually hit equip all, and then there will be a rank up button that replaces this one right here. When I click on it, I will subsequently go up to rank 2, and then I will have access to hard slash over here. Now, every character has an associated star level. Just because they're 3 stars does not mean like they're the best. Well, generally speaking, pretty much like all units have a use in this game. And so whilst Makoto is a natural 3 star, you can see that down here, I can actually go over to Ascension, and if I get any Makoto shards, I can actually go up to 5 stars with her. And then the last tab for characters is unique. So this is a recently released system. The unique equipment system is essentially like every character gets their own unique equipment, right? So if I come over here, we have Kiaru, and Kiaru is able to get a unique equipment called the Chaos Grimoire. And what this unique equipment, or UE, abbreviated does is it changes her skill 1. So we refer to this one as skill 1. And so just to be very, very clear, this one up here, the Union Burst, is your active skill. After that, we have the skill 1 and skill 2 down here, reduce armor and lightning sphere. And then your EX skill, which is just a passive skill. Generally, it's like boosting their main stat. So for Kiaru, who is a sorcerer or mage, she is going to get a magic attack. So if I click on this one over here, you will see boost own magic attack by 15. It's pretty much like a static stat. All right, so coming back over here to the unique equipment, essentially, this is probably like more of a late game feature. But again, in a nutshell, this pretty much just grants her bonus stats as well as a change to her skill 1. And if you would like to know more about this, like I definitely have a lot of UE videos, so you can check them out. But to be honest, as beginners, you really don't need to pay attention to this too much until a bit later. All right, and so that's pretty much the characters themselves all kind of talked out. And so let me head back to the main menu and have a look at what I want to talk about next, which is this guy over here. So essentially in this game, we have primarily two currencies. We really have three, but the third isn't really used. We have mana over here, which is essentially the currency that you use to equip like everything or upgrade everything. For example, if I was to come back to characters and I went into Kiaru and I wanted to upgrade one of these skills, unfortunately I cannot upgrade it, but if I did like hit this button, it would actually cost this mana currency up here. On top of that, actually upgrading my equipment does cost mana as well. So a lot of people at certain points in the game, they will be mana starved. There are various ways to get mana. It's pretty universal. Like pretty much if you do anything, you'll get mana. That's pretty much it in a nutshell. And so this currency right next to the mana is the gemmies, right? So it's your premium currency, the currency that you use to refresh your stamina, the currency that you use to pull on character banners. Speaking of character banners, it is this one down over here. So as you can see, Gacha. I'm just going to set this show downloading for Gacha off, but essentially it is 150 gems to do one draw, and then it is 1500 gems to do a tenner. The only advantage in doing a 10 draw over a one draw is that you are guaranteed a 2-star in the 10 draw. 2-stars, generally speaking, are pretty common. Like, let me have a quick look at the details actually. So I'm just in the draw rates tab, and as you can see, a 3-star character, which is max rarity, is dropping at 2.5%. And then on the other hand, the 2-star characters are dropping at 18%. And like, so many 2-star characters are very, very meta. Honestly, even a bunch of 1-star characters are super, super meta right now. Even our Pekarin, especially actually our main girl Pekarin. So yeah, that's essentially how the gacha system works and like how these gems feed into it. But other than using the gems for pulling on characters, we can actually restore stamina with the gems. As you can see, I have 120 total gems. I can restore my full stamina, 120 stamina each time for 40 gems. And the maximum amount of times that I can actually recharge my stamina is 40 times. However, each time, like in intervals of like 3 or 6 or whatever, this jewel cost will actually go up. And so that's pretty much the utility of these gems in a nutshell. Now here, I want to talk about a few different things because there is quite a lot going on here. And a lot of it is actually locked behind like these different stages. So to be honest, I think it's time to switch back to my main account because like I can't even click on these guys over here, which is kind of weird. All right, lads. So welcome to my main account. Let's go back to where we left off. And as you can see, all of these menus are available now for us to talk about, which is a lot less restricting than what we had before. So let me start off with the main quest over here. This is essentially like your story mode, although I think the story, like the cutscenes, are actually like put somewhere else. And so I'm just going to go back to Juno Plains, which is our world one over here. And so honestly, like this system is pretty straightforward. You finish 1-1, you go to 1-2. You finish 1-2, you go to 1-3, all the way up until the end. And typically speaking, the last stage of a particular world, so in this case 1-10, is going to feature a boss. So as you can see over here, what I just did was hold tap on this over here, and this displays like this description here. And this is actually a really important mechanic for like your early game. So as you can see, physical, a reptilian warrior that wields twin blades, blah, 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 deals medium physical damage to one character at random. And on top of that, blinds as well. So the reason that this is really important is because if they do physical damage, then you want to bring physical tanks. Sometimes there are going to be enemies that are like almost immune to physical damage or almost immune to magical damage. They're like big rocky golem guys. So like if you guys see them, then keep that in mind. So just whilst we're on this menu over here, as you can see, we can actually get 3-stars for every single stage. So to 3-star a stage, essentially you have to A, clear the stage, B, make sure that all of your party members stay alive during the end of the stage, and C, they finish within the allocated time, which is 1:30 per stage. And generally speaking, each of these stages have 3 stages, if that makes sense. Now, what you're gonna see over here are item drops, right? So every map has actually 3 items dropping. Depending on what is displayed here, there are actually different drop rates. So the first 2 items, I believe, if I remember correctly, they are at a 30% drop. drop rate. So that means that this sword and this buckler is at 30% drop rate. So that means that these glasses are at something different. And generally speaking, I believe it is at 20%. So what that means is that if you are looking for a particular piece of equipment, you should probably look for a map that drops it on the first two items. All right, so coming back out of this one over here, as you can see, this is all under the normal blue tab. And so as you progress through all of these maps, you can actually switch over to the hard mode. So this guy over here. And so let me just get back to the map one because it could just be a little bit daunting. And so my guys, welcome to hard mode map one. As you can see, each of these stages have these character icons above them. And what these character icons represent are their shards or their nodes, right? So for example, this one is Kokoro. And if I was to click into this one over here, you will see that I actually have to fight a Kokoro shadow. However, upon completing this stage, I will actually have a chance at getting her memory shard. And if you remember back to that character upgrade screen, we actually use these memory shards to star up our units. So Kokoro, although she is a 1-star cost unit, if you farm her enough, you actually can get her all the way up to 5 stars. On the other hand, all of these hard mode stages, they have equipment drops as well. But the drop rates on these three items are actually identical at 60%, which is different to the normal stage at 30, 30, 20. And so that's pretty much like hard mode stages as well as normal mode stages in a nutshell. Main quest in a nutshell. And so with that being said, let me head on back to the main quest and explain a few of these other ones. Grotto over here is essentially a bunch of virtually free resources. Here we can earn twice a day EXP and mana. Remembering that EXP is used to level up our characters, if I click into this guy over here, you can see attempts left is 0 out of 2 because I actually finished it today. I can go ahead and click into it and then start it and finish this stage to get some EXP pots. And so if you were paying attention about the goal before, this is the golem that I'm talking about. A monster of stone whose sturdy body grants it solid offense and defense. This brown golem has immensely high physical defense, so that means that you want to bring mages to deal with him. But with that, I digress, so let's get out of here. Although I forgot to talk about this system right here. So Princess Connect employs a skip ticket system in which we have a bunch of tickets. I have 5,800 of them. And when you guys successfully 3-star a stage, you guys can actually go ahead and use these skip tickets to pretty much entirely skip the stage. The skip will compensate you in EXP, it will compensate you in all of the materials. I'm pretty sure there is like virtually no downside to skipping. Honestly, a great quality of life feature. It's a massive reason as to why I play this game. It really respects your time. And so yeah, that is Grotto in a nutshell. It's essentially split into 2 different rooms. You got the EXP and then the mana rooms. And then you can clear the EXP rooms twice and then you can clear the mana rooms twice. And obviously the mana rooms give you 2 of the attempts to earn you a pretty respectable amount of mana. All right, let's get out of that one over here and have a look at dungeon. So this one's pretty interesting. Unfortunately, I can't enter it right now, but like you really are just climbing a few floors and then finishing a boss at the last floor. Every time you complete each of these floors or even the boss floor itself, you will earn these icons, sorry, these coins up here. These coins are called dungeon coins and you can use them at the shop to redeem different things such as character shards and equipments. This dungeon system, as well as the grotto system, they are both locked behind, or rather their attempts are locked behind the daily reset. Now, as for this one down here, Sanctum Survey, this is pretty much like very, very similar to Grotto, where it is essentially a resource stage. So if you guys remember that unique equipment from before, to build or even upgrade unique equipment, you need these heart shards over here. And these Sanctum Surveys are essentially how you get them. However, again, these are probably going to be pretty hard to do. So like a little bit outside of the scope of a beginner's guide. All right, so coming back out of Sanctum Survey, we have Clan Battle over here. So we are starting to get into the end game of things. So if I go ahead and click into clan battle, you will see a bunch of bosses. And essentially in a whole month, you have 5 days of clan battle. Over these 5 days, you will have 3 attacks to be used on any boss that you would like. However, currently you have to actually finish each of these bosses before you can progress to the next one. And so what that means is that you can use an attack on this guy, but until this guy dies, you cannot use an attack on the next 2 bosses. So you're going to be looking at clearing all of these bosses with 29 other people. This clan battle system is pretty much hinging on like you trying to get a full clan together. So that is this guy over here. And so honestly, for a beginner, you probably just want to join any clan ASAP, because obviously with the clans that have been around for longer, they're probably going to be looking for more like experienced players. However, when you're approaching level cap or when you're hitting level cap and you're getting stars on your units, so current level cap is 120, you're probably going to be starting to look at some of these clans, hopefully to if you want to be more competitive. And so after that, coming coming back over here, what we have is Battle Arena and Princess Arena. Battle Arena is essentially kind of like your ghost PvP type of content. So for example, I have third place over here in my sights. I can go ahead and click him and then I will see his team over here. And then down here, after analyzing their team, I will be forming my own team to go ahead and attack that team. If my attacking team is successfully able to beat their defending team, then I win. However, if their team is able to time mine out, then they win. And so again, for this game mode, we get these coins up here, which are the arena coins, the battle arena coins. And then on the flip side of it, we have another arena called the Princess Arena, which is essentially the same thing, except you're running three teams. So as you can see over here, we have three question marks. Each of these question marks, you can see party one, party two, party three. And essentially what it means is that I want to be fighting these three defenses with my three defenses, even though I can't see them. So I'm going to go ahead and click that one over here. As you can see, party one, party two, party three. And so as I go through each of these three tabs, you can see that my team is changing. Unfortunately, I can only use each of these characters once. So I got my Nozomi over here, Christina, Yukari, Halloween Miyako, and Arisa. So I can't use any of these characters in my team two or my team three. And so the victory conditions that I described for Battle Arena are essentially the same over here, except for the fact that there are three battles going on. So if I can win two out of three battles, then I will have successfully won the entire battle, won the war, and take their place. And so that, my guys, is a summary, a pretty decent summary of the two arenas. All right, so after that, we have this guy down here, Tower of Luna, or commonly referred to as Luna Tower, because that's just how it was translated from the Japanese version. So like I mentioned earlier, this is essentially like your endless tower thing. Luna Tower comes back every single month, as you can see, period Jan 5, 1 PM to Jan 10, 3:59 PM UTC. And each time it comes back, you actually are able to clear new floors because they have added new content. In a nutshell, you have to clear, for example, 167 before you can go to 168. I'm pretty sure this is pretty logical. But to be honest, Tower of Luna is a little bit hard. And so I would say that this is more, again, trending on like your end game content. However, with that being said though, there is no missable content over here because like if, for example, our max floors is 170, and for example, I was only able to clear like 159 this time. When Luna Tower comes back in February, I will start at 159 again, and then they maybe will have added up to like 190, and so I can go from 159 all the way up to 190. But yeah, in a nutshell, it's clear a floor, progress to the next floor, clear a floor, progress to the next floor kind of thing. It's pretty fun, and it is another source of those hearts that I mentioned before to create your unique equipment. However, with all of that being said, I believe that it's pretty much all of like the active game modes. And so let's go back to the home menu and have a look at the rest of the UI. This button up here changes your wallpaper from like the static to the dynamic one. So this is the static one, and then this one is like the dynamic one. This button over here is how you determine your wallpaper. So for example, if I wanted Ninon to be my wallpaper, I would save that, and you will see Ninon is here. This one just rotates the background and kind of zooms in, as you can see right there. And then this last button is to let you take a nice screenshot by hiding the UI. Down over here, we have the shop system, the notices, missions, and presents. So if I click into the missions, this is essentially where your dailies live and your normal missions also live. On top of that, anytime Crunchyroll or Cygames decides that they want to be like a little bit generous, you know, throw some gems out, it will arrive in your present box right here. And so the last button that I do want to talk about is this shop button, which is where we spend a whole bunch of those coins that we just talked about before. In the normal shop, you're able to buy EXP pots as well as these refinement crystals. When you get to it, your equipments are going to be able to be refined. You're just going to be using these crystals to refine them. Then moving along, we have this dungeon shop over here. And so as I described before, these are the dungeon coins that we get from clearing the dungeon. And then we can use them to buy these sets of shards, these sets of 5 shards, as well as a whole bunch of equipment. I definitely do have a video on these dungeon shop priorities, like which character shards that you should get first. So therefore which characters you should max first. And everything that I said about the dungeon shop applies to the arena shop as well as the P arena shop. So as you can see, we've got the equipment down there as well as some character shards up here. And so after that, what we have is the divine amulet shop. So every time we roll a duplicate unit in the gacha, so just this guy over here, if I hit a 10 draw and then I get a whole bunch of characters that I've already had before, we are actually rewarded with that currency that I just showed you before, divine amulets, or DA for short. So using these divine amulets, we can actually buy shards for pretty much any character that we own. And then of course, using these character shards to then eventually ascend our characters all the way up until 5 stars. And then the last shop that's available over here, the clan shop, essentially in the clan battles, every time you're successful or every time you do hits, stuff like that, you will get some clan coins. Same deal deal as the Dungeon Arena and P Arena shop. Now this shop over here, the bonus shop, which isn't actually open right now, I might actually be able to show you since I've only triggered it 4 times out of 5 times today. So let me go ahead and go into main quest, and I'm just gonna skip some stages for like some materials or something. So I'm just gonna go ahead and skip this stage. So 1, 2, 3, I only have 3 attempts that I can use. Use that, skip, and then we should get our reward. Skip 1, skip 2, skip 3, which is absolutely tragic. I only got 1 shard out of 3. But I forgot to mention that these shard drop rates are at about 50 to 56%. So, you know, your luck is gonna vary. And so voila, we have the bonus shop open. So let's visit that bonus shop right now. This bonus shop is triggered whenever you spend stamina. So that is why I had to do that. And so in a nutshell, this bonus shop allows you to buy a whole bunch of EXP potions as well as these pieces of equipment, which are randomized. My general advice, especially for beginners, is to just buy out the entire shop. Like, you're gonna find EXP potion chokes, you're gonna be in dire need of equipment pretty much all the way up until you catch up, and even when you catch up, you're also gonna be choking there. And so after I have bought out all of these equipments, I can now click close now, and then my bonus shop is going to close. As I alluded to before, this bonus shop can occur 5 times a day, can be triggered 5 times a day, and before the next one can be triggered, you must close the previous one. So yeah, that's pretty much the bonus shop in a nutshell. And if I go through this UI, I'm pretty sure I've gone through all of the story, I've gone through a whole bunch of the quests. So let me just quickly take you through this story mode. In a nutshell, all of the story, all of like the narratives and stuff are stored here. So if I click into this main button over here, which I'm pretty sure I've not clicked into for like a whole year, you will see we have all of these prologues as well as chapter 1 through 2. I believe we're up to like chapter 10 now. And essentially these are a whole bunch of cutscenes, sometimes like fully animated, most of the time fully voiced. And you can actually just watch through these as if it was kind of like a visual novel. Potentially even better than a visual novel because they're animated so well. And so coming back from this one over here, that is the main story at the very, very top. What we then have are the character stories down here. So I've actually read like all of the character stories. Well, I've clicked into it at least. But in a nutshell, it's like your Yuki character is going and interacting with each of these characters individually. However, as you can see up here, we have the Gourmet Guild. And if I scroll down a little bit more, we have Twinkle Wish. What this means is that all of these characters are kind of like loosely grouped together by either factions or different groups that they're part of, right? So for each of these groups or factions, there actually are like some of these cutscenes, some of these stories for each of them. As you can see, Gourmet Guild, Twinkle Wish, Labyrinth, as we just saw, Carmina. So these certainly operate in the same way as the other ones. And then last of all, we have these extras over here, which are pretty much the ones that are kind of like part of the unlocks. So like when you unlock dungeon, you see a couple of cutscenes. And then if I come back over here, I'm pretty sure when we unlock arena, there's cutscenes, guild house, there's cutscenes as well. Just stuff like that, right? So we have events over here, and I'm pretty sure every single event that I've played through, I can actually go ahead and rewatch. So yeah, that's actually really, really freaking nice. I really like that there is a collection of all of that. And speaking of events, like, don't worry if you feel like you've missed out. Honestly, there is not very much that you can FOMO out of in Princess Connect. Pretty much everything is going to get a rerun, from like the ReZero collabs that are upcoming to like some of the other ones where there are like limited events, like the summer events, Halloween events, they all get rerun, and eventually we get an event compendium. So yeah, again, don't feel like any FOMO. As long as you start playing and you keep playing, you're eventually pretty much going to get like every single character, as well as actually having a chance to like play through every story, stuff like that. All right, and so what we have landed in here last of all is our guild house. So as you can see, my guild house is not looking too hot except for the llama over there. But essentially this is like your furniture system. This is kind of like your decorating system. Very, very common in games. To be honest, there are two primary things that you need to think about when you're in the guild house. And the first is that there are actually furnitures which give things, like give resources. So for example, all these things over here, these podiums, they are generating stamina for me. And to collect it, all I have to do is go ahead and tap on it. So as you can see, I just gained 24 stamina. On the other hand, if I click this menu over here and I click gifts over here, I can actually go ahead and pick one of these gifts. So I click give, and then I can click on any of these characters and give them this gift. And obviously I can't feed these guys any gifts because they are all at max bond. But this bond level is really important because these are essentially what is gating your stories that we looked at before. So for example, we have Yui over here. If she was only bond level 1, I would only be able to access her first story. On top of that, every time you read a story, you also get some like stat increase as well as gemmies. So it's probably in your best interest to actually go ahead and feed them these gifts and then read those stories. But with that, I think that's actually it. And I am losing my voice like crazy because I'm pretty sure I've been speaking for over an hour. And so hopefully that was a pretty good introduction on this game, maybe a beginner's guide. I pretty much ran through like every single friggin' system there was. And so hopefully this video has helped you kind of understand everything that is going on. But if you do have any questions, then drop them down below and we will try our best to answer because we have been playing this game for one and a bit years now. So yeah, that is my secret question to you newer players. If you have any questions, then drop them down below. But other than that, let me know how you guys are going with this game. Is it fun? Is it exactly what you're looking for? And for you veteran players who have somehow managed to make it to the end of the video despite knowing all of this, let me know if you have missed anything. But otherwise, like, to be honest, I'm really excited for another influx of these players. I promise you guys, this is a pretty freaking rad game, so come and enjoy it. And so if you guys do end up leaving a question or your thoughts down in the comments below, I would really appreciate it because it means you've made it up until the end of the video. It's probably going to be like a 40-minute freaking video. But regardless, I appreciate your patience, so thank you guys so much. On top of that, if you actually found this video helpful or if you just kind of liked it, then please consider actually liking it. And if you would like to see more, then please subscribe. But otherwise, welcome to the world of Princess Connect. And as Pekarim once said in the anime season 2 episode 10, I swear to God because I've seen it. Actually, I'm lying. Crunchyroll, please don't sue me. But Pekarim did say all good things must come to an end. And so thank you so much for watching and I'll catch you guys in the next video.